Revolution Radio proudly presents live from Phoenix, Arizona, the Truth Deny Talk Radio with host Roxy Lopez. Join us here for topics you won't hear about on mainstream news, such as chemtrails, GMOs, nutrition, and conspiracy facts regarding your personal sovereignty. Humanity is 7 billion strong. We are the majority. And now, live from the Valley of the Sun, your host, Roxy Lopez.
And a very good evening to everybody. Thanks for joining us on the Truth Denied Talk Radio. And of course, I'm your host, Roxy Lopez. We have an exciting show for you, and we're going to get right to it in a moment. I want to thank everyone for your emails, your questions, and a lot of people that are reaching out with health issues and so forth as well. We're glad to help you out. We're glad to also forward any of your emails to Dr. Will Spencer, who's really been handling a lot of the traffic that's coming to our website. So if indeed you do have health issues, please, by all means, be sure to email me at info@thetruthdenied.com, and we'll get your emails forwarded to Dr. Will Spencer or somebody else who might be able to help you. Tonight's show is going to be just absolutely fascinating. Listen, there is sufficient evidence to prove that the governments of the world are secretly and covertly contacting extraterrestrial beings. The most publicized incident is the Roswell crash of 1947. Military seized and recovered the alien craft, which contained extraterrestrial life form. Though the United States Armed Forces to this day maintains that they recover was an experimental high altitude surveillance balloon from a classified top secret program called Mogul, we all know that just isn't true. Locations such as Area 51, which is a remote detachment of Edwards Air Force Base, nestled in Groom Lake, Nevada, is thought to have housed several recovered ET craft as well as ET beings. Area 51 does not appear to be on any public government maps, yet it is shown in a civil aviation chart published by the Nevada Department of Transportation. Currently, the U.S. military denies its existence as well. Other proof of ETs reside in famous abduction cases going back to 1961, the case of Betty and Barney Hill. And, of course, even before that, 1897 Stockholm case of Cornell H.G. Shaw, the 1950s abduction case of Antonia Villas-Boas, and those who study UFO abductions such as Bud Hopkins, John Edward Mack, and the famous Dr. Alan Hynek, who coined the phrase close encounters of the fourth kind, all who have been discredited by mainstream science. And what about those strange lights over Arkansas in 2007, followed by the Phoenix lights in 2008, or the New Jersey UFOs that the History Channel even reported in 2009, and 2010's UFOs over Manhattan. In 2012, photographs of the UFO near the sun. What was that all about? The list is endless, people. Yet all of these sightings are considered to be either hoaxes or non-existent and debunked by military and governments of the world. One important question to ask, of course, are these truly ET crafts or are they military experiments, and we're going to dive into that and bringing us up to date. What about the Philadelphia experiment involving teleportation of the USS Eldridge in 1943? What about the Montauk Project, where the U.S. Air Force created an interdimensional portal or stargate? And Project Pegasus, who's headed up by Andrew Bishago, who's been on the show before, and he will be coming on the show again next month, by the way, who is acclaimed chrononaut and time traveler. Project Pegasus is dedicated to lobbying the government to release secrets of teleportation and time travel and the Mars Jump Room as well. And what about just recently, the secret space plane, the U.S. Air Force Robotic X-37B and their classified mission? So you see, is everything that we're seeing in our skies extraterrestrial? Or is it military technology? The gentlemen that I will have on the show this evening are going to explore this with us. We're going to talk about cloaked craft in our skies, ET, or military technology. That is the question. Is the military covering up the fabled reverse-engineered UFO craft technology? A superconductor has the ability to carry electric current without dissipation. The perfect diamagnetism of a superconductor makes it possible to levitate magnetic objects. Unquestionably, one of the most famous men associated with the S4, Sector 4, that's at Area 51, by the way, is physicist Bob Lazar, and is a name numerous people associate with alien spaceship reverse engineering. Our guest tonight will be Sean Gautreaux. Sean is a book illustrator in New Orleans. He revived a hobby of recording lightning in May of 2011. It's fabulous stuff. If you haven't seen it, go to his website. Go to YouTube and take a look at some of the fabulous videos. Everything, by the way, that my guests are doing is linked up at thetruthdenied.com. The homepage will take you to their websites. Well, after taking thousands of photographs and hundreds of hours of infrared video, Sean Gautreaux, in June of 2012, began releasing his series, What is in Our Skies? And we have a presentation of that as well on thetruthdenied.com. His discoveries point to the possibilities of drone warfare, the weather machine, and even domestic drone spying. Now, at over 4.5 hours long, his series continues to grow. Topics touched upon have been weather modification, black projects, chemtrails, cloaking, NASA, UFOs, anti-gravity, Project Bluebeam, and ancient accounts. His focus is currently on flying rods, skyfish, that are somehow associated with the craft and clouds themselves. They are up there, no doubt, right above our heads. We have one of the least four scenarios going on. Either they are all military working alone, or all ET working alone, or both, in conclusion or in conflict. And it's starting to look like conflict, says Sean Gautreaux. Jim Kerr is also going to be on the show right alongside of Sean. Jim is a retired police officer with an extensive background in criminal investigations. He oversees a family-owned law enforcement supply business and works part-time in a private high-risk security along with conducting high-profile criminal investigations and surveillance for a private investigation firm. In January of 2011, Jim took an interest in chemtrails and began researching and videoing the skies over the Antelope Valley in California, aka Aerospace Valley. After a year of research, video, and photos, Jim opened a YouTube account in April 2012 named Chemtrails AVCA, also linked up on thetruthdenied.com, by the way. Jim is now a chemtrail activist with a passion for revealing the truth and exposing information on the criminal activity behind Agenda 21 and others. With Chemtrails AVCA created in May of 2012 on YouTube, it was game on for Mr. Kerr. Paying close attention to the sky, he began seeing and videoing strange anomalies in and around chemtrails over Aerospace Valley. UFOs, orbs, skyfish, rods, and signatures of various size triangular craft that were cloaked. Studying the patterns of these craft, researching advanced technologies lead him to what is in our skies, Sean Gautreaux. Sean and Jim quickly became friends and exchanged a lot of information. The craft are so advanced, they are beyond science fiction, says Jim Kerr. Weather warfare machines, surveillance, chemical cloud cover, able to direct electrical charges, aka fake lightning, at any target they wish. The disturbing reality is these craft are real, and their presence is worldwide, yet they are also denied. Please welcome and give your full attention this evening to, first I will invite onto the show, Sean Gautreaux. Sean, welcome to the show, and we're so happy to have you. Thanks for coming.
Roxy, thank you for having me again.
Absolutely. And let's invite Jim on. Jim, welcome to the show, and thank you also for taking the time to be on the program this evening.
Hi, Roxy, and thank you for having me on.
Absolutely. Let's start with you, Sean. Other than I've obviously given a background on both of you, anything else that you want to add to that? Because if not, Jim may as well add to whatever background. And if not, we can actually jump right into the subject.
Hey, sounds good to me. I wanted just to take a second to thank you for your support, not only of what I do, but what you do in general for humanity. Thank you, Roxy. You're an angel.
Yes,
and I just wanted to get that across. But yeah, let's jump right in. It's going to go pretty quick. There's a lot of information. I don't know how much we're going to be able to cover, but this show's going to be over before you know it. So yeah, what you got?
Okay. Thank you, Sean. And Jim, as well, if you wanted to fill in any blanks that I may have missed, go for it.
Oh, no, we're all good to go.
You're good to go. Now, for the listeners, I just want to let the listeners know there are some links in the chat room, some photographs, anything that you missed during the show, listeners. As you well know, we'll have an extensive video footage for you with the archive of this show available for you. And, of course, a wonderful article with all the contact links in that article and on that video as well. So if you do miss something, don't worry. You'll get it on a repeat tomorrow as well. And it will be indefinitely located on thetruthtonight.com. So don't worry about it. The site is actually turning into quite an encyclopedia of references. So you and Sean and Jim will go down in history as well, and we love that. Now, the work that you both are doing is just absolutely amazing, and I think it's become a question amongst anybody who's either a UFO type of researcher or an astronomer or those who are, you know, chemtrail activists, etc. The worlds are colliding. The activism worlds are colliding, and there is a lot of fighting going on, and so-and-so is right, and so-and-so is right. So what I like about your work is – both of you have something that is in common that I love, is that you are presenting your ideas, and you've both done fabulous research. And you're not, both of you are not getting in that sort of activism role of fighting everybody because their idea isn't right. You guys are just putting it out there. And I can say for sure with Sean's work that when Sean first came to me and we started to advertise his work to give him a platform for all of his work, I will say this, that in the beginning, I don't think there were a lot of people, but from Sean, from your point of view, there are more and more people seeing the activity, aren't there, in the sky?
Yeah, definitely. When I initially put out the videos, the first set of videos in June of 2012, there were a good group of people on YouTube following this, and luckily I ran into Jim within the first 2 weeks maybe. But even since October, the last time I was on the show, there's been more and more people picking up on this. And it's anywhere from people thinking they're documenting UFOs to just seeing something strange in the clouds that they maybe captured on film but just don't know what to think about it. So there is a growing community of people noticing these things, and that's great. People are looking up. You know, I hate to use a cliche, but that's really what it is. And it's grown tremendously in the last year. And it's fairly easy to do. This is, we're not using any special tricks. Jim and I both use infrared. It's pretty effective in cutting through the haze and really see what's going on up there. But all you really need is just a camera or a video camera or a good zoom, and that's really all you need to get started. And people have actually done this, And it's good to see them coming on. And people contact me all the time. Sean, I think I saw this in the sky. Would you look at my video? And I say, yeah, you've got something there. Just post it. And they're doing it. And they're starting channels. And it's growing. So that's good to see.
And great. And what about you, Jim? Are you experiencing a similarity in more and more people waking up to the fact that there is something strange going on in the skies?
You know, I'm seeing the exact same thing as Sean is. You know, I'm hearing from people from around the world, even sending me emails with photos they've captured, you know, of the various different size triangular shapes, UFOs, calling, asking, you know, what's your opinion of this? You know, there's just a growing number of people that are taking notice of this. And, you know, like you mentioned, you know, that some of the bickering that goes on between the different, you know, people, you know, looking into chemtrails, people looking into UFOs. And I've noticed that, you know, the people reporting on chemtrails strictly don't want to talk about these craft, don't want to talk about the other anomalies that Sean, myself, and others have seen. You know, so there's kind of a division there, you know, where they don't see the whole picture. They're not grasping how everything is connected.
Yeah, I can agree with that, and that's unfortunate. I also, you know, my personal opinion is that I think that's purposeful.
I think so, too. You know, there's a lot of covert things going on, you know, to you know, destroy this, you know, the search for this truth, you know, and it's and we'll get into some of that later on, too, you know, some of the context that I've personally had, you know, that, you know, some of it's a little disturbing.
Absolutely. Now, let's start with what are you videotaping? What is it? What is going on that you both are videotaping? Can we start with you, Sean? And then, of course, Jim, go ahead and, make your comments as well. Sean, what's going on up there? What are you getting on tape?
I wish I knew, but I'll tell you what, it's some freaky stuff. And initially when I started videotaping, it was really about trying to capture lightning. And then I realized that the lightning was horizontal and pink, and there was a drought going on. We weren't getting the storms that were coming in. And I started noticing vortexes, what I called them initially, different things like that. It just didn't make sense. And I'm videotaping from my backyard, and here it is going on over my head. So I started looking into satellite images and radar and things like that, and then really kind of breaking down the video that I took. And once I'd sit there and really analyze it frame by frame or speed it up real quick, you started seeing the craft. And initially I wasn't sure that there were craft, but I had a good sighting on a certain day in August of 2011 to where I knew I was looking at something solid. So that pretty much established that, yeah, these are craft. It's not just wind vortexes. And it kind of went from there. And it was easier to pick up once you realize kind of what you're looking at. And there's a lot of things going on. There's so many different things. But I'll be honest, when I found Jim after putting my stuff up there, it was very comforting to know that, no, I'm not nuts. Jim and I are videotaping the same kind of things, and he's in California. Because initially I thought this was maybe localized to New Orleans. It had something to do with Katrina or the BP spill or something like that. But after seeing Jim's stuff in California and then noticing, okay, that not only in California, it looks like Canada and the UK and Italy and Russia and so on and so forth, it looks like a global condition, and we have craft above us.
Well, here, you know, I started off, and I still am, you know, a chemtrail activist. But when I started videoing the chemtrails, you know, all these other anomalies started showing up. I was catching UFOs. I was catching orbs in the sky. Now, I'm still doing, researching as I'm filming all this stuff, looking at other people's videos. I'm seeing these triangular shapes in these clouds. I'm seeing these clouds puff up from an aspirin-sized cloud into an enormous cloud in a matter of minutes. You know, I mean, in a matter of 1 minute, this thing goes from an aspirin-sized cloud to this massive cloud. This is kind of a real quick funny story. You know, I was videoing a chemtrail, and I saw all these orbs. There was about 20 orbs flying in and out of the chemtrail, and I'm going, what is this? You know, so I told my wife and my three adult children about it, and they thought I was nuts. You know, my wife was ready to have me committed until I burned it onto a DVD and put it on the big screen in the living room. And, you know, they immediately started believing everything that I was seeing. But, you know, then, you know, on the craft, you know, I knew I was seeing something up there, you know, the repetitive motions of them. In our area out here in Aerospace Valley, you know, I would see these things, these cloud formations come out of the hills like a train following each other. And you could tell there were separated groups. Some would travel north, south, east. It didn't matter if the wind was blowing. Then I was listening to Lihara from Brutal Truth Media, Maui. And she was talking about these, you know, the optically armored craft. And I'm going, you know what, there's something to this. And then, you know, I ran into Sean's channel and just started putting two and two together. And I said, you know, I've got to get together with Sean and we've got to start exchanging information. You know, so, you know, that's basically, you know, how I got, you know, started seeing these things.
Sure. How high are these things flying? I mean, are they, can you see them with the naked eye?
Now I can. I can pick them out pretty well now. And it's, I've said it before, it's kind of like training your eye, you know, picking out patterns. And before it was tough, I'd only see them in videos. And if I was standing outside, I'd maybe pick up something. But I'd really find it when I'd take the video and enhance it. And I was like, oh, yeah, there it is. But I was standing out today, and these things were above. And I can pick them out just all day long at this point.
Well, and I really, listeners, you really need to take a look at some of the photos that Jim and Sean have presented, because what they do is they highlight the areas in which these craft are, so that, as Sean had just mentioned, you begin to train your eyes so you can start actually picking them out. Now, you say that they're very low altitude, 500 to 800 feet, and going pretty slow. Are they moving? They're going against 25 to 35 mile an hour winds. That's what you were saying. So are they floating in the clouds and just sort of do they park in the clouds? That's what I'm asking. You know, and just stay in one place for a little while, or do they keep on moving?
They actually, you know, I have seen them, you know, when this, you'll see this aspirin-sized cloud puff up, and then inside this cloud, you'll see various shapes, and they move at different speeds. I have observed them moving extremely slow, to where the only real way you could really track their movement is like in time-lapse video. You know, the time-lapse, you could actually, you know, speeding them up, you can actually see the movement of the individual craft, and they're various size craft. And you know, each craft is doing something different. You know, you'll see them flipping over, and as they actually, like, flip over backwards, I've seen them flip over backwards, emitting, like, a cloud-like material out of them. And they're, you know, I'm not sure how many craft are in one cloud, but they all work together as a unit, you know, dispersing this cloud-like material. Now, these things are chameleons in our sky. I mean, they can imitate real clouds. I have seen them build cumulus clouds. I mean, huge amount of cumulus clouds. You know, so their movements, you know, the best way to capture them, you know, is with time lapse.
And I can imagine that. And I've seen a lot of the time lapse filming that both of you have done, and it's that is the way you can start to get a picture of this. You know, for those of you who are listening to the show right now, if you want to go and take a look at that, at both of the YouTube channels, again, those are both linked right on the Truth Denied website. So just click them and get to it. Now, you know, I'm a little confused. Are chemtrails involved? In other words, who is ever spraying what they're spraying in the skies, these artificial clouds, these big X's, these long contrails that spread out over the skies, are these two different machines? In other words, these craft that you see that are more triangular, that have a poof of smoke come out of them, so forth, and the chemtrail military planes is what that looks like. Are these two different planes, two different crafts doing two different things? Again, thanks, Jason. So, Sean, you were just about to say something when we went to the break. What you know, are these different craft, the chemtrail craft, the that are spraying these big contrails, chemtrails, or are these all one and the same? Or are you not in that? Do you not have a dog in that fight?
Well, first, let me echo what y'all said earlier. The whole thing about fighting with in-groups is a distraction. It was probably set up from the beginning as disinfo and ways to break down the communication. And it's really about getting your point out. It's not about attacking this guy or that one in their theories, because they may all be right, or some of them be right, because there's a lot of stuff going on. And the chemtrail programs are not necessarily for one goal. It could be 10 different goals. So that's the way I look at it. And chemtrails is something that I came across chemtrails in a different way. I didn't start really making the connection between chemtrails and the craft until I started really seeing the craft. And I've got plenty of videos on YouTube that show chemtrails, or whatever they may be, being sucked up by these cloaked craft. And it's getting pretty darn obvious at this point. So I would say definitely there is a connection between some of these chemtrails and the craft that we're witnessing up above.
And what about you, Jim?
Well, I agree 100%. You know, I believe that there's different chemtrails for different purposes. And I believe that the chemtrails that we're seeing targeted at these craft, you know, are specifically for these craft, because they're normally short trails. You know, you'll see the jet flying, you know, towards one of these craft. They'll turn on the spray before the cloud or the craft that are in here. And as soon as they pass that cloud, they turn off their spray. And a lot of times, you know, and then you'll see these craft actually, you know, the whole unit, you know, like the main craft and the other ones in this cloud formation, you'll actually see it move into the chemtrail, you know, and Sean and myself both have captured these craft, and of course you can't see them, but you'll see a bump, you'll see something that actually went into the chemtrail spray, and when you analyze the video, you know, when you slow it down. And they'll be traveling at various speeds. I've seen them really fast go hit these chemtrails, make a disruption in the trail, and then, you know, but you slow it down, you add some effects. If you add like the Sony bump effect, you'll see something that's there, you know, it's raised up on the screen, you know, and you know, these effects aren't going to show something that's not there. And you'll see this image go travel into the chemtrail. And, you know, they're doing something, you know, they're getting something out of that mixture.
The craft, the triangular craft or so. Okay. So they're sucking something up out of that cloud.
I believe so.
Okay. And by the way, you know, with activists, you know, it's very popular, chemtrail activists, I should say, are very aware of the sprayers going in and out, in and out. And I see that when they're doing heavy spray days or so forth. I see that happening all day long. I'm in complete agreement that process exists. So with that in mind, Have you been able to figure out, now I hate to keep pointing back at this, but have you been able to figure out why they're in the clouds, these, let's call them triangular craft, why they're in the clouds, where they're coming from? Do you have any ideas yet?
I've got a few ideas. Initially, I didn't know where they were coming from. I got a little hint about essentially looking in the woods, and I have a feeling that there's so many of these craft that they can't necessarily put them on any airport anywhere. I believe they're housed in essentially wildlife, federal wildlife land areas. I think that's their landing zone. I also think that they're possibly coming out of the water, which is kind of strange. But I've got some video, and I've seen some things without recording it myself, to where there's a possibility that they're popping out of the water. And another thing, it almost seems like they're concentrated around coastal areas, if I can just throw that out there.
Okay.
Here's
okay.
Something.
And what about you, Jim?
You know, living here in the Antelope Valley, you know, we've got NASA. We have NASA, Dryden Edwards Air Force Base, Northrop, Skunk Works. I mean, the list goes on. This area has been known for the last 50 years of its secret bases in the mountains surrounding the Antelope Valley and other areas. You could go online and Google it, and it comes up with four or five known black budget bases. What I have noticed is, and Sean is 100% correct, in mountainous areas, I actually know the general vicinity of two of these bases up in the Angeles Crest Forest. I still haven't gone up there, and I'm kind of reluctant too. I keep inviting Sean to come out here on vacation and spending a week out here with me, and we could do some research. And we both came to the conclusion that we, if that would happen, we'd probably disappear off the face of the earth.
Yeah, we'd get in a lot of trouble real quick, Jim.
Yeah, I know we would. But anyways, you know, I have watched these cloud formations. And these are in our area, it might be a little bit different from what Sean's seeing. But I have seen these individual cloud formations, you know, like squadrons. You know, each cloud has got its squadron of craft in it. I have seen them rise up out of the mountains from behind another hill. And we're talking, these mountains aren't huge mountains. You know, I don't know the actual altitude, but you'll see them actually rise up. You're like popping up. One will pop up. Another one right behind it. These things are actually vertically taking off from inside these bases. And it's amazing to watch. I mean, it's mind-blowing, you know, because there'll be days, some days if we have a clear day, there's not another cloud in the sky. Then, and my wife and I used to joke, you know, it would always be like between 9 and 10 o'clock in the morning, these things would come out. You know, I'd look at my watch, you know, at 11 o'clock, I said, man, they're late. I go either that or they're not experimenting today or whatever. But these things will literally rise up out of the mountains, and you might see 50 different squadrons, and they split up. I mean, it is so, you know, it is so obvious that something's going on. I mean, it's mind-blowing. They'll split up east, west, north, south. Wind could, you know, we get high winds out here. The wind could be blowing 65 miles an hour, and I've seen it, you know, and these things are at low altitude, and they go against the wind, you know, and they go off. And here's the crazy thing. At the end of the day, they all come back and go back and descend down into the mountains. And it's like, come on. You know, I mean, it's unbelievable. Sean's got to come out here on vacation. So
one day, one day.
I think a lot of people are going to want to come out there for after this show. It sounds fascinating. And so there is a clockwork, like you said. There's an actual certain time they start showing up, and then they retreat back into these mountain ranges. Is there, just out of curiosity, any of your neighbors, obviously you and your wife are viewing these, but are there any neighbors that you have that you've turned on to that can see it as well?
you know, we live on a small ranch. You know, we got horses and animals and stuff like that. You know, so our neighbors are kind of spread out. But I have, you know, talked. You know, I've been breaking, you know, the couple neighbors that I do talk to in on chemtrails. You know, and I haven't got, you know, quite gotten to the craft yet. You know, I'm trying to, you know, a lot of people, you got to ease them into everything else that's going on up there.
Gotcha. Yeah. Well, it's beyond a UFO story at this point, I think.
Oh, it is.
Right?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then talk about confusion. I mean, it's like people are just now wrapping their minds around that, you know, contrails that go from horizon to horizon and spread out and cover the entire, you know, viewing sky are not normal. Right. And now you're going to introduce like the, you know, X, Y, and Z to it. So I could see that, but, you know, I can understand that. Now, Sean, what do you think about the sylph clouds or the sylphs? And you also have referred to something as colony of money spiders. Are the clouds alive? And then, of course, you quote public law 105-85. Are we acceptable collateral damage now? What do you mean by all of this?
Well, sylphs was the term I really only came across after posting stuff online and on Facebook, and people said, oh, that's a nice sylph. I'm like, what is a sylph? So I looked it up, and it goes back to Greek mythology, and it's a flying living entity in the sky, apparently. And maybe it has something to do with Native American thunderbirds. I really don't have any idea. But initially, I kind of blew that off, I'll be honest. Because I thought everything that I was looking at were essentially craft. But some of these don't necessarily look mechanical. And that's why I think we've got two things going on up above. I think we've got a mechanical craft, and we just may have a sylph or some kind of entity. And money spiders, if nobody's really heard of these things, I remember hearing about these as a kid. Money spiders, or colonies of spiders that live in the clouds, in the atmosphere, not necessarily in a tree on the ground. But that's what we're told, and I'll tell you the truth, we're getting a lot of money spider silk being dropped in the area, especially in the colder times. So I am now open to the possibility that sylphs are real, and the possibility that they create our clouds. And I really think we've got two things going on up above. One's mechanical, and one may be as natural as fish in the sea, just above us. And then you break it down to, well, are they benevolent? Are they malevolent? Are they indifferent? Does it matter? I don't know. And it's still a process for a lot of us, kind of throwing these things out on the table. What do we have here? What correlations can we make? What doesn't make sense? And just trying to get to the bottom of it.
That's interesting that you talked about money spiders and the webbing, because, you know, as you well know, for the last couple of years, we have been testing chem webs and find them to be anomalous, and we really don't know what they are. Do you think that these chem webs that are falling from the skies on heavy chemtrail days could be part of the money spider deal?
Is that possible? It is possible, in that if their single strands get wrapped up in some kind of wind coming down. But I've also got video of a large chem web coming out of a cloud, and I know that cloud's got some kind of engine in it. It seems like it's popping off the bottom of the engine. And I've thought for probably about a year now that whatever this chemtrail material may be, it's probably electric, conductive in some kind of way. It's almost like it's getting wrapped up or collected in the mechanism and then thrust off, and just gravity is just pulling it to the ground. That's just the way I see it.
So something that's burning off, and it's really just sort of garbage?
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay.
Residue.
Okay.
Yeah.
And Jim, you know, you spend a lot of time with chemtrails as well. Do you have a lot of the similar points that Sean made? I mean, do you have similar perception, or?
You know, I haven't really, you know, other than seeing videos, you know, on YouTube and that on the chem webs and that, I haven't really seen anything like that in our area. You know, as far as the sylph clouds, you know, I have seen those, you know, over us, you know, and I've done some research on it. You know, my personal belief, though, is, you know, and from extensive research that my wife, both my wife and I have done, you know, from biblical research, you know, the Book of Enoch, is that, you know, we're looking at, you know, something that is interdimensional, you know, possibly demonic. You know, so, but, you know, and to get into that, you know, we would need, you know, three or four shows. So.
Oh, sure. Yeah. I did see some of that information as well. And that's always been something that's been considered, I'd say, by mainstream for forever, you know,
right.
The aspect of the demonic, you know, sort of beings. You know, you were recently contacted by an alleged NASA scientist. Can you talk about that, Jim?
Yes. In fact, the day before he contacted me, you know, my daughter was down here visiting from Oregon, and we're all outside, and there was this V-22. What are those? They called up, Sean, the Osprey. This thing flew out of what we call Alien Mountain, where we see the craft come out. This thing flew out of the mountain, came out to our ranch, and we're talking at 300 foot level, made two circles around my property, and flew back up into the Angeles Forest. And, you know, I saw this and it was like, what? You know, the next day, you know, I get this message from this gentleman that wouldn't reveal his name, you know, nothing. You know, he was a 30-year employee with NASA with top secret clearance. And he wanted to get together with me. You know, he lived here in the Antelope Valley. He said, you know, I'd like to get together with you in a public location, you know, at you know, your convenience, and discuss these cloaked craft and chemtrails. You know, so I messaged him back, and I said, sure. You know, I said, but, you know, you're going to have to give me some more details as to who you are, you know, and basically messaged back. And then, you know, the message got strange. You know, he went on to say, well, he wanted to know where I was getting my information at on these craft, and, you know, what good is it going to do to video this stuff? And he said, you know, he made like a, you know, a similarity. He says, now, he said, if you were a pig on a farm and you knew that you were going to be slaughtered, you know, what good would it do you to, you know, who's going to save you? And I'm going, wow, this is wild. Well, I declined to meet him, you know, and basically, you know, I gave him a bunch of links on the internet. You know, I did explain to him, you know, where I was getting my information from the craft, you know, that I was visually seeing these things. You know, I've been following their pattern, their repetition. You know, I've been documenting for a long time, and there was something there. And after that, you know, the guy has never contacted me again.
I think that's interesting. Sean, have you ever been contacted by anybody in regards to your work as far as somebody that's sort of high security clearance type character?
No, not really. I've gotten some emails from some people over the last year saying, I need your email address because I've got to send you some really interesting photographs, or I've got some information from you or for you. And I'd send them an email and whatever. I never hear back. So I've kind of given up on those jokers. I don't really pay attention to them, and I'm just forging ahead with what I've got.
Absolutely. Jim, you mentioned that as well, that individuals working in the aerospace field have dropped several hints. What do you mean by that?
There's been two individuals that are there, and this is all by chance. You know, I didn't go out soliciting these people or anything. These are like friends of friends of friends, you know, where I happen to be in the same room with them. And, you know, and just in general conversation, you know, at a get-together, you ask, you know, what do you do for a living? And, you know, you just regular chit-chat. And, you know, the one, you know, it was in the aerospace. And, you know, I couldn't help myself. You know, I've got this sense of humor that, you know, I've got to, you know, I have to dig. So I started talking to him about, you know, advanced technologies. And with both these individuals, and it was at two separate times, you know, two separate locations. But, you know, I started talking about the craft, you know, the repetitive motion of them, you know, and just everything we've discussed so far. Well, the expression on these people's faces is priceless. You know, the jaw hits the ground, and they give you the look like, how do you know about this? And they, of course, you know, won't come out and explain stuff to you. But they did drop some, you know, some hints. The one mentioned to me, he says, well, he started talking about nanoparticle paint and how some of these craft need to be constantly repainted, that the paint doesn't last. Now, and there again, he didn't go into any detail, but he also said that they fly around the country to unknown locations. They don't know where they're going. They board a jet, no windows. They don't know where they're going. They go to these different locations specifically to repaint aircraft. And then they don't even know where they're at. The other person, a different agency out here in the Antelope Valley, you know, I did the same thing. You know, talked to him about the craft, explained what I'm seeing. And he looked at me and he said, in his exact words, he says, what we have is beyond science fiction. And I was like, whoa, now they don't want to talk to you no more. I mean, these, you know, with these get-togethers, it was like, you could just see them saying themselves, I'm not talking to this guy. But it's mind-blowing, you know, and they really didn't have to tell you anything. It was just in their facial expressions and the hints, you know, something is going on.
Yeah, that sounds pretty scary. Actually, yeah. If somebody just sort of admit in this nanoparticle paint that, I mean, I have no idea what they're talking about, actually. And speaking of paint, what color are these craft? Do they have a color?
Black. Super black.
Super black. People should be able to see them then.
Well, when they say super black, I think they're meaning super invisible. And what Jim said earlier kind of corresponds with a little bit of information I got from a friend in Montana at the time. It was within the same week. And I talked to Jim about this and this guy who went around painting stuff. And I got a call from a friend in Montana who's up by the Canadian border. And he said, Sean, you know, I was watching a train load of, I think it was M1 Abrams tanks. And they were all covered in this white sheer plastic like you see on brand new cars. And he said the wind was peeling them back. And I could tell that the tanks were painted black underneath that. And he said the way it looked was it was a very iridescent thing. You look at it from one angle and it was very, very black. And then you saw it in the sunlight and it was almost like a rainbow shape. And I'm thinking, is this nano paint? So I ended up looking up carbon nano paint, which is referred to as super black. And the more I dug into it, I realized that's a way to cloak things if you use this specialized carbon nanotube paint. And it's kind of like absorbing radar, but you're not only absorbing radar signals, you're absorbing the light. So the light does not bounce off this object back to somebody's eyes. It's essentially cloaking. So that week was great, and I think that inspired part 18 of What is in Our Skies. I think that one's all about cloaking and practical ways of doing it. And there are several ways of doing it. And once you get past the reality that cloaking is possible, then it starts making a lot more sense.
Oh, sure. It makes sense to me right now. I mean, as far as, you know, drones go, I mean, they must be using this with drones so that people don't even notice them up there. You know what I mean? So that drones can fly in tight between two houses, even, you know, yeah. Small drones. So it makes absolute sense to me. You both have something in common. Well, you have a lot in common, but you have a person in common, and I'm real interested to hear about this. Bob Lazar. You both are, I guess, a fan of Bob Lazar's work, or Bob Lazar lends credibility to your work and vice versa. Do you want to talk a little bit about that? Why Bob Lazar?
Jim, you want to start on that?
Sure. Now, you know, everything I'm going to tell you is basically hearsay, but it is total confirmation of Bob Lazar's story to me. And to Sean as well. This friend of mine I've known for 15 years, you know, a close friend of both my wife and I, you know, we both have common interests in horses and that. Well, and this just happened here again, just by pure chance. You know, we were at a church Christmas party at her house, at her ranch, a couple of days before Christmas. And I was standing there, and there was a group of people talking about chemtrails. Well, of course, I had to jump in on that conversation. You know, and somebody in the conversation, you know, then it changed. There was somebody mentioned UFOs. So I had to jump in and talk about, you know, the UFO connection between chemtrails that I was seeing. Well, my friend was standing within earshot, you know, 4 or 5 feet away, and I didn't even know she was listening. She grabs me by the arm. She takes me into her back office, and she goes, "I didn't know that you had an interest in UFOs." And I said, "Well, you know, I mean, I'm no expert, you know," I said, "but, you know, some of the things I've been seeing." And she goes, "Sit down." And she says, "My ex-husband," you know, and I can't remember how many years she was married, but, and this goes back into the 1980s, she goes, "was a nuclear physicist who worked at Los Alamos and Area 51. And she says, you know, and she gave me his name and everything, and I confirmed it. I mean, you go on, I mean, he's on the internet. I'm not going to mention his name now, but you go on the internet, you know, he worked for, was at EENG, you know, at Los Alamos. She says, then she says, "Have you ever heard of Bob Lazar?" I said, "Well, yeah." And she says, "Well, you know, my husband and I were good friends with him, and my husband worked with him both at Los Alamos and at S4. I go, "You're kidding me." She goes, "No." She says, you know, so, I mean, it was like, I mean, what are the odds of somebody you've known for 15 years, you know, telling you this? You know, she, you know, they were friends that had been out to dinner before. You know, she says her husband, when all this came out, he backed off his friendship from him, you know, because of his job, his position and everything else.
And I want to welcome you back. If you're just joining us, our guests this evening are really filling in the blanks with, you know, some technology that's going on in the skies that we're unclear if it's ET, if it's military, if it's both, if there's a war going on up there. All we know is there's a lot of mayhem and chaos going up. Of course, we're speaking with Sean Gautreaux and Jim Kerr. And Jim, you were just before the break talking about a friend of yours whose husband was a nuclear physicist and worked with Bob Lazar at Los Alamos over at S4. And so whatever happened with that? Sorry, we had to interrupt you for the break.
That's okay. So, you know, I asked her, you know, what she thought about aliens. And she said, and she told me, she looked at me with the most serious look on her face, and she says, "They're real." She goes, "but," she goes, "I do not believe they're extraterrestrial." You know, she kind of follows the same thought as mine, you know, that they're interdimensional fallen angels, and, you know, and that we could get into that a little bit later on. But then she hands me a stack of papers. She says, "Here's some papers from my husband." She says, "You know, I've been holding on to these since the late 80s. She goes, "I'm going to do nothing with them." She goes, "Here, Merry Christmas." You know, so I'm going, you know, now I went through all these papers. In fact, there was actually two complete sets of these papers. And I gave Sean a set as well. And, you know, everything in these papers can be found. It took me some time to research it on the internet, but all this information can be found scattered on the internet. But it was interesting getting original copied documents and papers from the 1980s. Now, these papers get into a multifacet of a listing of all the alien crashes, you know, throughout the United States, all the bodies that were recovered out of these crashes. It gets into how the government has been working with these entities, for years. It goes into the artificial breeding programs that the government works with these entities. There's diagrams of the artificial womb that'll hold hundreds of these little tiny entities. I mean, it's bizarre. It's wild stuff. And it goes into all the different realities, you know, different levels of reality. And what I found most interesting in this paperwork was the reference to alien abductions. And where the government, part of their deal was they were going to allow, you know, these entities to abduct, you know, human beings. But what I found interesting was that how they made the statement that an alien abduction can be stopped. And basically, you know, it went through, calling on the name of Jesus, these entities will flee. I mean, it's incredible. I mean, it's just, and of course, you know, that's led me down a whole nother road of investigation on top of that.
I'm sure it has. And how did, you know, I just have to ask you, and then I'm going to ask Sean a question. How did that make you feel when you actually were handed, you know, these, you know, documents from, you know, original documents from the 1980s with this type of information? I mean, how did that make you feel? I mean, seriously.
I know it. Well, you know, I mean, nothing shocks me anymore. You know, even from back in my days in law enforcement, you know, I mean, I think I'm prepared for just about anything, you know. So there was no shock. You know, I had no shock. You know, my kids were a little shocked about it, and my adult children, you know, but it was like confirmation for me that, you know, everything that you've heard before, you know, there's some reality to it. You know, actually having a longtime friend whose husband, you know, worked with Bob Lazar. And she's also good friends with John Lear as well. And in fact, you know, she, you know, I can't go into too much stuff without her permission. In fact, I'm hoping, you know, that, you know, she'll come forward with some more information. But it's pretty mind blowing, you know. And what are the odds of somebody that you've known for 15 years and right at the right second, they overhear you say something? And all these subjects never came up with this person before. And it's like, I mean, that blew me away more than anything. You know, call it what you want, synchronicity or whatever, you know, to be there at that precise moment and have somebody say, hey, come here, you know, let me tell you this story. And here's all these papers.
Yeah. I can imagine. And she probably just thought, you know, it wouldn't interest you. I mean, that's probably it, because, you know, like you said in the beginning, you're at the party and she pulls you aside and says, you know, I didn't know you were interested in UFOs, and then starts to, she probably just thought you wouldn't be interested in it. You know, that's all. So, yes, I can imagine the shock. And Sean, you also are a believer in Lazar's work and find it very validating as well. And can you express why?
Certainly. I remember seeing Bob Lazar on TVs on those cheesy UFO shows in the 80s. And I paid attention to him. I was like, who's this guy? And then what they did to him was they dug up some kind of a problem with his educational history. And he claimed he went here at some point, or he had some degree, and then they proved that he didn't. So therefore, everything he had said for all of his life was a bunch of nonsense. Well, you know, that's what they do to people. But when I started looking into, you know, the details of the craft, I realized that at least the mechanical man-made ones and probably the other ones, their engines on the corners, on the back corners, are square-shaped or rectangular-shaped. And it's not necessarily something that really shows up in nature as a square. But I knew, following the square clouds and looking into it, that those engines on the right and left corners are rectangular-shaped. And then hearing Bob Lazar's reports of being shipped out to Area 51 in a bus with covered windows, and you know, he'd go out there every day. But one day he was able to see an aurora taking off from the area. And he described a rectangular-shaped engine on the corner of a craft. And he said the craft was absolutely tremendous, and he was able to watch it take off. And I'm thinking, okay, Bob Lazar saw an aurora with a rectangular engine on the corner. This is what I'm seeing. So I know what I'm seeing. So maybe he's actually telling the truth, you know. So I'd definitely give props to Bob Lazar. You know, even though he's out of the picture at this point, I think he was telling the truth.
Well, you know, and the Aurora Project, you know, anyone can look that up as well. I think Popular Mechanics was the first mainstream magazine that actually put out photos in the, I want to say, the late 80s about the Aurora Project. So, you know, this is all validating. And it would seem that if they were going to arrive at, you know, what you and Jim are seeing in the skies today, you know, that's 25 years later, 30 years later. From the original Aurora Project is what I'm saying. So, you know, now what are flying rods? Because I've looked into flying rods as well back in the 80s. I think it was Jose Escamilla that did a fantastic documentary on rods. How'd you come across rods, and are you seeing them and filming them as well?
Yeah, I am, and I didn't expect it. And with my videos initially, I was really kind of speeding them up to – get the rotations in the clouds down pat and everything else. But when I'd watch them at regular speed, I'd notice like a flash here and there. So it really took the time and patience to go frame by frame. And when I went frame by frame, these things just started showing up, these darting objects. And I knew with my camera settings and everything else, it wasn't birds, it wasn't bugs, because I had birds and bugs to compare to. And after watching flash after flash, and then I came across one that was really interesting that could not be explained any other way, other than some kind of flying entity. And I couldn't tell really the scale of it, but it was there. So I put it out there kind of asking, okay, fellas, what is this thing? And I really didn't get a lot back. At this point, especially since like October and November, I've really been going through my videos and trying to find as many as I can. And I believe I've been able to find them in my still shots. I use a Canon Digital Rebel with a pretty decent zoom on there. And I'm pretty sure that I'm finding stationary flying rods or skyfish or whatever you want to call them, not only in the clouds, but connected to the craft. And there were some, you know, there's a lot of different patterns in the clouds that I've seen. And a lot of them I've attributed to, it's kind of like a zipper shape or a zipper pattern where you've got like a straight line down the middle and then you've got a series of hatches across it. I initially attributed that to pulse detonation engines that would kind of go putt, putt, putt. But some of them really seem to be... either flying rods themselves or the pattern that they leave in the clouds. So I definitely think that these things are associated in some way in many of these craft, let's call them.
Mm-hmm. So can you see the flying rods with are they visible through the naked eye, or do you only catch them when you're doing a download?
Really, when I go through the videos, mm-hmm. I mean, I'll stand outside and I'll look up and check things out, and I'll see something flashing across. But I don't know what it is. It's really the video that tells the truth, mm-hmm. and I can't really. I mean, I speculate here and there, but when you get down to the video, it's in there. So it's not something that I can make up or speculate on. And again, any of my video or any of my photographs are up for review by anybody, any expert. to take a look at them. And it's there. I can't deny it. I've just got to figure out why are they there and why are they skipping off craft, at least some of them. So there is a connection between these things, whether they're archons or demons or angels or just as I said earlier, just as common or as natural as fish in the sea. I don't know, but they're part of it.
Mm-hmm. And for those of you who don't know what flying rods are or never heard of them, we'll put some photos into the video for you. The last one that I saw looks sort of like a caterpillar. That's the best way I can describe it. Sort of looks like a flying caterpillar without wings, but has little, like, I don't know, things that go around and around. I can't even explain it. I can't put it into words on the air. But we'll get some photos of that, too. And then do you have isolated photos in your video as well that they can see? That, like, do you have just a still photo of a rod?
To me? I'm
yes,
sorry.
Sean.
Yeah, I do. It's really going through the videos and looking at them again, or I'm sorry, the still shots, and saying, that's not what I thought it was. There's something sitting there. It's almost like a little wavy snake in a way.
Okay. And those of you who went to the forum, because we did put a link to the forum with a tremendous amount of photos for you to look at as well. And I think that being that the chat room is fairly quiet right now and has been since both of you gentlemen went live on the show tonight, I think that they're probably looking through this and just sort of listening to what you all have to say. Which is a good thing because people are paying attention generally when that's happening instead of talking about laundry and what they're cooking for dinner. So so that's a compliment to both of you. You know, you mentioned feeding time and the transfer. And you say, Sean and Jim, that that's the hardest part to explain. But could you try to explain it anyway?
I'll give it a shot. And I've been saying for months through my videos, I'm going to get to this transfer thing. I'm telling you guys, I'm going to do it. But it's really hard to explain because it's going to take several weeks really to go through the videos and put it together in a way that makes sense. This is a process that is separate from chemtrails. All right, that's something else. What this is, and I almost call it like a gas station above New Orleans, it's a transfer of material. And I started picking up on this early, and a lot of people have seen this in some way. Maybe some of the listeners out there have seen clouds at the same altitude moving in different directions. Not necessarily, you know, a combination of fronts coming together. But that's what I started picking up on. I'm like, why is that cloud moving this way? It's just at the same altitude. And then I would see an interaction between the two. Something coming out from one, some may call it a tentacle or something, but just attaching to the other one briefly and then the other one just moving along. And it seems like it just, I call it the transfer because it's a transfer of material. I don't know what it is. It could be refueling. It could be resupply. But it happens often, and not only just above my, you know, a house in New Orleans, but I've seen it in many other photographs and videos, you know, from all over the place. There's a great photograph on your site, Roxy, that somebody submitted, and it's probably the best one that I've seen that encompasses the different aspects of this transfer, whether it's an offload of materials going off Earth to Mars, I don't know, but they're moving something. And if you can imagine, and some of you out there might be able to relate to this, it's almost like if you can imagine like a pack of hot dog buns, as silly as it seems, just tubes like bladders linked side by side. It's almost like they're transported into a certain area where there's a set of awaiting craft. And then these bladders or containers are punctured and electrically transferred to the craft, and once the craft are filled or refueled or whatever, they start popping off. They start taking off in different directions. That's the way I see it. What is it? I don't know, but it's there. And one day I'm going to put out a video explaining this. It's of course very unexpected, but the patterns are there. It's real.
And you know, and that's not too far of a stretch anyway. You know, KC-135 tankers, that's what they are, refueling tankers. And you know, for anybody, you know, who doesn't know that, we have refueling in the sky from plane to plane. And what you're basically describing is something that maybe transfers some sort of energetic something, whatever these, you know, it might not be, it's obviously, you know, not going to be gasoline or air fuel. I mean, sorry, jet fuel. But something is happening up there, like some kind of supply station, you know. And if you look at cars, electric cars, I mean, look what they're setting up all over the country, a place where you just plug in your car and then it, you know, flies, you know, drives another 500 miles. So it's not too far of a stretch to say that they don't have them in the sky either. I think it's interesting. Jim, what do you think about this?
You know, I have seen the same thing Sean is talking about, and it is very hard to explain. In fact, you know, Sean does an excellent job, you know, in describing it, you know, and my thoughts are, you know, if some of what we are seeing up there, you know, is advanced, you know, man-made technology, you know, it's got to be refueled somehow. You know, if these things are going to stay, you know, in the sky, you know, creating cloud cover, creating some sort of cloud-like material that we don't know exactly what chemicals or what's in them, you know, something, they've got to be getting their fuel somehow, you know, and there again, you know, we're shooting in the dark on a lot of this, you know, we don't know if these things are nuclear powered, if they're, you know, or what, you know, it's obvious they have some sort of anti-gravity technology, but they've got to be getting the fuel from somewhere.
Are these being seen all over the world, by the way?
Apparently. I can really only comment on what I am capturing in my videos, but I can also see through videos and photographs that other people put up around the world that they're capturing the same thing. Jim?
Same here. You know, I mean, I'm only, you know, seeing what's over you know, the Antelope Valley here, but, you know, just watching other people's videos, you know, and some of the emails that I get and some of the photos that are sent to me, you know, from India, from, you know, the UK, from Australia, you know, that these things are being seen. And then when you just watch a video, even chemtrail videos, if you're watching somebody else's, you know, chemtrail videos, I've seen them, you know, and I know Sean has too.
Sure. Jim, can you comment a little bit on, very curious about fallen angel technology?
In my opinion, and from my wife and I's, my research, that we've, you know, spent a lot of time on research, you know, I'm trying to think of how to put it, because it's hard to, in the amount of time we have, to explain the whole thing. You know, people, if they're interested in this, you know, need to do their own research. As far as the fallen angel technology, you know, this goes back to, you know, Genesis 6 of the Bible, you know, where the angels fell from heaven, disobeyed God, you know, and started, you know, and mated with humans. You know, their offspring were the Nephilim. When the Nephilim died, you know, their spirits became demons. That Noah's flood, after the flood, you know, it says in the Bible that the same thing happened again, started happening again with these fallen angels. And there's a whole history of that. And you also get into the book of Enoch, which isn't part of the Bible, but was written back in that time period, you know, that these angels, these fallen angels, you know, gave mankind advanced technologies. Even way back when you know, Enoch, you know, wrote down the, you know what he was seeing, you know, this technology, these advanced technologies. Now, you know, there again, you know, you start connecting all the dots, you know, from all, everything that we know about extraterrestrials from 1947 and before and to current date. you know, it, you know, if you do an extensive, exhausting research, you start connecting all these dots, and for me, you know, I believe that, you know, we're looking at advanced technologies that are from these fallen angels, given to certain men for evil purposes. You know, basically, you know, it's the destruction of mankind. You know, it's just destruction of what God created. You know, and there again, you know, this really gets heavy, but, you know, you've got Satan, who despises God's creation, you know, is bent on destroying man. You've got, you know, Luciferian Illuminati humans that are working with Satan. You know, so you see where I'm going. This thing gets so involved, and for the average person, it's so mind-blowing and far-fetched. But that's why you've got to do your own research. You know, so this is where I believe that, you know, these ETs at Area 51, these ETs at all the stories of these ETs, you know, we're dealing with fallen angels. Now they're creating, and you know, their offspring are being created in labs, which are basically modern day Nephilim. You know, they're not fallen angels; they're basically offsprings, but they're created in a laboratory setting. You know, they're half human, half alien, whatever you want to call them. And this is where I believe you start seeing the alien grays and some of these other different species, reptilians and that, which are basically human hybrids, you know, where the DNA has been changed. You know, see, the thing with Satan is he cannot create life. You know, only God can create something out of nothing, life. But Satan can alter.
And welcome back. I just want to acknowledge a couple of people that are very interested in the show, Sean and Jim. So congratulations on just really giving a lot of information that's touching people. Etienne has said he's photographed some of what you're speaking of, and he's talking about he's seen them in rock formations or other natural formations. And he said he found them around local hotspots here at China Lake, but also found doing a search around the Archuleta Mesa Dulce area. And then Mercedes Benoit said, I swear I saw a flock of birds one evening. This show sizzles. I'm sitting here going ballistic over how much I'm following. LOL. And thank you to have been validated. And Izzy has said that sometimes she sees faces in the sky. And she also had a comment back in the 70s. Izzy had a neighbor in Vancouver who invented a motor out of magnets. It required a small electric charge to start and only stopped when stopped. It would run forever. It levitated, and she saw it levitate, and she says it lifted off the ground, and he told me he was going to for a patent on it, and that it would prevent accidents because magnets repel and our cars would be like hovercrafts. But they never saw any of that come forward, which is very typical. And then other people like Margareta mentioned free energy and other things that just never get patented, and we just never see the technology. By the way, do you think that that is a way to keep the public mystified or dumbed down by simply never really exposing a grander mosaic, if you will? Sean, you can answer that if you will.
Yes, indeed. I go back to Nikola Tesla and his associations with J.P. Morgan. And this you can look up anywhere. Tesla created free energy. Built something for Morgan, apparently, out on Long Island. And Morgan realized that it was free and he couldn't make a buck out of it, so he blew it up. And a lot of this goes back to Tesla technology, and I think they've been using it for quite some time. I think the Philadelphia experiment has a lot to do with what we're seeing up above. So once you take that into account, that's 1943. How many years ago was that? So they've been doing this for quite a while.
Yeah, and Sean, why aren't you buying into any alien theories quite yet?
I'm not going to accept the explanation as being fully ET or UT or whatever you want to call them, because the last things that our wonderful government has shown us out of black projects has been the B-2 and the F-117, and that was in the 1980s. They were designed in the 1970s. At this point, they're junk. So where has all the money gone over these years? You know, black project funding has not shrunk by any means. It's gone up. And so for the last 30 years, what has that money gone towards? They haven't shown us. And I'd like to know, before I buy into anything, what you got? What are you flying around? And like Jim said, beyond science fiction, I'd like to know what I paid for. So I think a lot of this stuff is theirs, and a lot of this stuff is you know, maybe ET. But until I see what they're developing and have been developing all these years, I'm not buying into anything.
Sean, what's the idea that you have, which is a correlation between the government's favorite pyramid and I, and something called hidden knowledge?
That's something recent. I've been kind of shifting my theories over the last 6 months or so, and it's really just kind of exploring the possibility of different explanations. And it seems like the ones that I'm looking at that seem natural, that seem biomorphic or organic, I hate to use that term, but more living than mechanical. These essentially, to me, look like a triangular shape with either a hole or an eye in the middle. And in late December, I was standing outside and I looked up and there was one that came across. I didn't grab my camera or anything. I just watched it. And it was a small triangle shape with a hole towards the bottom middle. And it was kind of ahead of the pack, meaning in front of the clouds behind it, just kind of moving along from south to north. And it, to me, just looked like as natural as a fish or it was just it was just kind of flowing across. And the hole that I speak of towards the bottom, if you can imagine like a whale blowing out water, this was like a whale or fish shape blowing out smoke or cloud material. And the more I look at all of these craft, whether they, I believe that they're man-made or natural, it kind of breaks down to a simple shape of a triangle with a circle in the middle. And some of the ones that I see seems like there's an indentation towards the top of the triangle that may be an eye. And the bottom, for me, looks like some kind of blowhole. And when you break it down that way and you start doing the research, because that's kind of something that I mentioned earlier, putting all the pieces on the table and trying to find an explanation for what this thing is, I've been looking into Egyptology. And this, to me, could be Horus. And Horus is depicted as a triangle with an eye in the middle. That's just kind of the way I'm leaning. And it's not to say that these are not fallen angels or anything to do with the Bible. They just very well may be the same thing. But that's kind of what I'm looking into at this point. Not only studying these as many skyfish and flying rods as I can find, but historical references to what I'm seeing. Cave drawings, etchings, anything. So it's starting to gravitate in that direction for me.
Sure. And what about with for you, Jim?
You know, I'm seeing the same thing. In fact, Sean, I don't know if you remember that one video where I you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't that what you were looking at when I did that shout out to you in that one video?
Oh, you've shouted out so many times to me, Jim. I don't know which one you're talking about.
it was that same triangular shape with the large blowhole on the top and kind of like the eye cut out on the top. And it was in one of my videos, and I zoomed in on it, And I said, this one's for you, Sean.
Yes, I do remember that.
Okay.
Yep.
You know, at, but, you know, there again, you know, there are so many things happening up there. You know, there's such a combination of things happening, you know, some mechanical, you know, some, you know, advanced technology of our own government. You know, I am, you know, my personal opinion again is we're dealing with, you know, advanced fallen angel technology, and we're seeing some of these entities in the sky as well. And, you know, so that's, you know, like I said, you know, before, you know, a person has to really do an exhaustive research on the subject, and, you know, it holds a lot of credibility.
Well, and would you both, would be suffice to say that you both do buy into the ancient alien theories then?
It's starting to look that way, yeah. It really is. I kind of blew it off for a while, but some of it's starting to make sense, indeed. And speaking of ancient aliens, I kind of mentioned this to Jim recently, that I came across Giorgio Tsoukalos from the Ancient Aliens show at a convention. And I went up to him and I said, all right, who are these guys in the clouds? What's going on? And he really didn't know. But I have a feeling in the end it's going to tie into this somehow. Yeah, because there's a very good possibility that this has been happening for a very long time.
And it would only make sense that there's so much that has been, you know, like you say, hidden knowledge. There's sacred symbols. There's hieroglyphs that really sort of depict, like the Eye of Horus and many, many, many other hieroglyphs that depict, you know, something that comes from the, you know, the chariots that come from the skies, the flying machines, etc. Isn't it Giorgio that wears a little flying machine pin on his lapel?
I guess so. But,
yeah, he's got a little fly. I think you could actually order them, but they were actually recovered. They're made of some kind of copper or something like that. But bottom line is there, and I'm just going to throw this out to both of you. Do you think there could possibly be a historical or a history gap between ancient, let's say, pyramid times, Egypt, and all over the world, the pyramids and Chichen Itza and all of these places that have these hieroglyphs? And could there be a sort of a missing time between then and now that, in other words, it seems that the ancient cultures were so much more aware, familiar, like the Mayan, let's say, or the Native Americans even, seem to be one with these extraterrestrials. And now you look at our modern day culture, and it seems like it's just a big shh, and no, and that's just a distraction, and don't believe in that, and we don't want to go there. Yet we're exploring other planets like Mars and go to the moon and Venus, and it seems like there's some sort of gap, almost like an amnesia. What would you have to say about that? Sean, you can go ahead and answer that.
I could see something like that. I would maybe blame some of our elders of maybe hiding the truth or erasing the truth. I won't mention the Vatican. No, I just won't do that. But I have a feeling that, yeah, they're a culprit in this. Yeah. We've been lied to, and we've had a lot of this stuff hidden from us. And ancient cultures, to me, are certainly more in tune with nature and what's around than we are today. We are a very technological society. We've got our heads stuffed in a cubicle and looking at a computer screen almost 24/7. And we don't look up, and we don't take into account what's around us. But luckily for me, I have the chance. I'm a book illustrator. I work at home. I set my own hours. I can go out and watch the sky whenever I want to. And that's what's kind of led me to this.
I think it's fabulous. I can relate. And Jim, what about you? Do you think there's an amnesia, or do you think it's been purposeful? And do you agree that in ancient cultures, it was dealing with our fellow extraterrestrial beings was more encouraged than it is now?
You know, I think a lot of the history has been purposely covered up. And there again, you know, I have to go back to, you know, biblical references, which I won't, you know, won't give the references, but, and I have to go back to these entities being, demonic, you know, in every society, in every civilization, you know, on the planet, as far back as we know, you know, has had contact with these entities in one way or another. You know, and then a lot of these places, it was the chief of the tribe that only had contact with them. And it, you know, overall, if you look at the history behind this, there was really nothing good that came out of it. You know, most of it was used for death and destruction. You know, and like a deception. You know, like a deception, and that's where I believe, you know, we're at today. You know, with the quote alien, you know, visitations and this and that, I believe it is a deception. You know, I believe that that it's one of Satan's tools to deceive us. You know, and so it's, and there again, you know, it gets so complex and so in depth that, you know, it just takes hours and days and weeks and years of research to really go into this, to go back to the ancient aliens. You take the ancient aliens, you know, and you compare what they're talking about in biblical terms. You know, it the only thing they're changing is the word extraterrestrial or aliens versus fallen angels and demons. You know, so you see what I'm saying? You know,
yes.
and this is a personal belief of mine, you know, and, you know, I'm not going to force this belief on anybody. You know, but they, you know, if anybody's interested in this, you know, it's the information is out there. And
so it's just all, it's repetitive then is what you're saying, but they just switched out the players or switched
exactly.
out the names of the players.
Exactly. You know, you take out ET and aliens and plug in fallen angels and demons and the demonic realm. You know, look at Jack Parsons. You know, he was one of the, you know, he was in the groundwork of NASA, the groundwork of Jet Propulsion Laboratory, Area 51. You know, at Area 51, he performed these demonic rituals, you know, and it was said that he tore a tear in spot in time space, letting these entities in, you know, and you look at his relationship, you know, with
Crowley.
Aleister Crowley and Scientologist L. Ron Hubbard, you know, the connection he had with them, you know, in the demonic realm, you know, and you start putting all these pieces together and everything starts making sense, you know, that, you know, are we being deceived? You know, our government, you know, governments around the world, you know, with Hollywood, you know, the whole agenda pushing aliens on us since we were kids, you know, and, you know, with this belief that, you know, that aliens are coming to save us, you know, I mean, what a deception, you know, if what I'm saying is true, and I believe it is, what a massive deception, you know, to, you know, ET shows up and no, we created you, you know, you need to change your religion, you need to have a one world order, you know, under us. I mean, just, you know, think of the possibilities of the deception there and how many people would fall for that deception.
Yeah, no kidding.
I agree, Jim, because...
Know, yeah. Yeah. Go ahead.
No, one of the things that really got to me is when they started flying these... Well, I don't know when they started doing it, but when I started noticing these things over my house. And you mentioned earlier, Roxy, the altitude. For me, they come in at about 100 feet. 200
yeah.
feet, you know, like real low. And I'm like, you're going to fly these things over my house and I'm not going to notice? No. And it's deception. And that's what really got to me. I'm like, no, you're not going to fool me. Uh-uh. So it's been a driving force for sure. And I agree with everything Jim said. You know, switching out names, whether it's ET or ancients or whatever, you know, deception.
Well, and what you're also describing, it, you know, is Project Bluebeam as well.
Yes.
You know, and that's something that NASA, you know, conjured up, a new age religion with an antichrist in its head, and starts a new world order via a technology simulated second coming, etc. So, you know, our own people designed that, you know, so to speak. So it would be just another page in that book, in other words.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I've been waiting for part four. Part four is asteroids. Oh, well, and now we've got some asteroids coming in. So,
well, yeah, no doubt. You know, I think that your correlation early in this show with Philadelphia Experiment makes a lot of sense. And also with the Montauk Project, the interdimensional idea there, and like you said, 1943. Where are we now? How much have we done? You know. And by the way, the Montauk Project was for a radar system. You know, and so was the Philadelphia Experiment. I mean, that's how it started. And isn't it just all the talk still to this day with HARP and chemtrails? It's all linked back into that radar system or that satellite system, an ability to be able to keep an eye on everything that we do, everything that we breathe, you know, smart meters, et cetera, that, you know, the grid that they have built around us. And at the same time, you're talking about these craft flying 100 feet over your house, but look at chemtrails. I mean, you can tell somebody, show somebody, you know, a big grid of chemtrails, and they can be convinced for a moment until the person next to them says, "Oh, come on, those have been around forever and ever. It's just increased jet traffic." Mm-hmm. And then the other person will go, you know, that you just had on the hook for a little bit, will turn around and say, "Oh, you're right, huh?" and walk away from it. What is causing this? Is deception, in both of your opinions, Jim and Sean, is deception just so good? Is propaganda just so fine-tuned that the average intelligent individual can't even smell a rat?
Yes. Yeah, they're pretty good at this, and their collaborations are much better than my perception, Jim's perceptions, and anybody else's. And I think they've been planning this out for quite some time. So,
what about you know, psychological experiments or subliminal experiments, etc.? Do you think that that's all existing as well for some of the more stubborn, more intelligent individuals?
I think it would have to be for their program, yeah.
And Jim, what do you think? As well,
you know, I think that, you know, we as, you know, humans on this earth have been so dumbed down, you know, fed so much propaganda, you know, the way the system's set up, you know, it takes a husband and wife to work full-time jobs to supply, you know, to support their families. You know, we're running around like chickens with our heads cut off, you know, and we're just in the average person, you know, is probably less than 1% of the world's population is seeing what we're seeing, you know, from the chemtrail, just the chemtrails alone, you know, and I believe the whole thing has been orchestrated, you know, for that purpose, to keep us blind, you know, so that, you know, we can't see, we can't hear, you know, we're too attracted to what's happening in Hollywood. We're too attracted to this, we're given, you know, all this, I call it tinker toy technology. You know, we're given the cell phones, the iPads, the computers, you know, we're allowed to have all this stuff to keep us occupied, to keep us blind as to what is really going on behind the scenes, you know, go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. Look at, we just did 2 hours, gentlemen.
Wow.
And I told you it would go quick.
And it did go very quickly. And I'm just going to let the listeners know right now that we are definitely going to be inviting you both back and to continue the conversation that needs to be continued, because there is so much that is happening out there. And I certainly appreciate both of you coming together. Even though you have some areas that you disagree on, you found where it's all relative to support each other's work. And so I really want to thank you for that, for being, you know, the two gentlemen that you are. It's a pleasure meeting you for the first time, Jim. And of course, Sean, it's always a pleasure working with you. Both of you, kick out your websites. And of course, we still have everything linked up, and we'll continue to have their sites linked up at thetruthtonight.com. And we've got a couple minutes. So anything, last words for the listeners?
Well, I'd like to invite you, not invite, but you've got an open invitation, Roxy and Sean, and film crew or whatever else, come out to the Antelope Valley and we'll have some fun. And God bless you for all the work that you do, Roxy.
Oh, thanks a lot. And vice versa, you know, thank you for your work as well. And Sean, what about you? Any last words for listeners?
Sure. Well, yes.
Yes, we're going down, man. We're going down after this show. They're coming to get us, the men in black, okay?
Yeah, I'm surprised I'm still here, but I will also invite both of you out to New Orleans. Anytime you want to come hang out, please do. And God bless both of you and the listeners who have taken the time to listen into this, and hopefully you start just looking up and checking out what's going on.
Yes. Absolutely. And there it is. It's the end of this show. And thank you both again. Big hugs. And thanks to the listeners for joining us one more time. This is The Truth Denied Talk Radio. I am your host, Roxy Lopez. And we'll be back for a brand new show date this Friday, the 12th, at 8 o'clock Eastern.